Praetor Amaltus.
What is it?
I have a report to make regarding the situation with the Aegis in Tantor.
Please, come inside.
Yes, Your Eminence.
So, Jin finally has his hands on the Aegis. It seems the boy wasn't good for much after all. Unless he can find what is lost.
Your Eminence?
Hector.
Yes?
Prepare the ceremony.
At once, Praetor.
Rex, Rex, still sleeping? It 2 days now.
His injuries were quite severe. The worst is over, but his body needs time to recover.
He'd better get well soon, or... Rex? What's that?
I'm leaving.
But where will you go?
Good question. Can't live on Gramps anymore. Maybe I'll head for Argentum.
Rex? You...
What the hell are you talking about, Argentum? What about Pyra? Do you know how desperate the situation is? Or have you finally lost it, you idiot?
I know, okay? It's just...
Just what?
I'm done.
Done?
When I became the driver of the Aegis, her driver, I felt like I could do anything. But I was just kidding myself. All I've managed to do is hurt her. Again and again. So, I'm done.
Oh, for crying out loud, Rex! She got herself caught to save you!
I know. So what?
So what?
Those guys are way out of my league. I can't beat them. It's hopeless. I understand that now. She'll be safe with them. They're not gonna hurt her like I do. So, I'm leaving. I've just been kidding myself all along. Me, a driver, in the end, salvaging is all...
You bloody idiot! Hurts, yeah? But that pain's nothing compared to what Pyra must be feeling right now. She went with those bastards knowing full well how much it would hurt. For our sake, not hers.
I get it, I know. But what do you want me to do? I couldn't even slow him down. Even the artificer's attack couldn't touch him. What chance do I have against a guy like that? The more I fight, the more Pyra gets hurt. She'll be... better off without me by her side.
Do you actually mean that? Do you not have the slightest idea how it felt for her to leave you?
With me here, he'll suffer even more, lose even more. So maybe... maybe Rex is better off without me. Rex, and the whole world, they don't need me. That's just how it feels.
Pyra thought you'd be better off if she was dead. Did you know that? She is planning to sacrifice herself to defeat them.
Huh?
You drove her to this, but here you are, giving up! You said you'd get Pyra to Elysium, didn't you? You'll eat your words just like that!
Hey, Mom? Dad? It's been a while. A ton happened, you know? I became a driver. And this girl is Pyra. My new partner. I know you'd love her. We're going to Elysium, Pyra and me. I don't know what's coming next, but you'll be watching over us, right, guys?
Forget it. We're a rescuer on our own. This loser, he's not the Rex we joined up with. Let him go wherever the hell he wants.
Come now, let's not start fighting amongst...
Let's give them a chance to work this out, shall we?
You know, I...
Nia, quite right. Rex definitely not behave like himself. Giving up after one loss? That not Rex I know at all.
But...
Now is not time for excuses!
Help me! Poppy?
Poppy is hurt to see Rex like this. Poppy and Master Pun are not real Blade and Driver. So Poppy and Master Pun looked up to Rex lots. Rex worked very, very hard to get this far. When Rex tries hard, Poppy and Master Pun try hard. Rex like Bullseye we aim for. Without Rex, we not know which way to go. So please, Rex cannot give up and stop here.
Poppy.
My prince?
Chum!
Huh?
My old man wants to see you. Time to go.
Esta cinemática me destroza por dentro. Es lo puto peor. Es lo puto peor. Hay cosas de las que quiero hablar, pero antes de ello no hay nada importante, creo. Dios, es que, o sea, cuando empieza Nia, ya es chungo. Luego llega Brigid y la bofetada duele. O sea, la puedes notar psicológicamente lo pesada que es. Pero luego llega Poppy y te mata por dentro. O sea, cuando llega Poppy, mueres por dentro, pero súper vasto. Es horrible. A ver, vamos a hablar un poco de esto porque aquí es donde empieza a desarrollarse un poco más la trama psicológica del videojuego y es una de las cosas que más me gustan. ¿Saben una cosa por la que me gusta mucho Evangelion? Voy a intentar no spoilearlo. Evangelion, además de muchísimos otros temas, trata uno que es el más básico, incluso diría. Que es, ¿qué pasaría si meterías a una persona que no es un superhéroe, una persona normal? ¿What? ¿Esto es tu idol animation? Dos, me molaría tanto si fuese una tía, me cago en Dios. En fin. ¿Qué pasa en Evangelion cuando coges a un chiquillo de 14 años y lo pones a intentar salvar el mundo? Que es algo que no es para un chiquillo de 14 años, porque es una cosa de superhéroes, ¿no? De gente que de verdad tiene ese complejo de Dios como para salvar el universo o el mundo o lo que sea, ¿no? Vale, Evangelion trata ese tema. Aquí pasa un poco lo mismo. Rex es un chaval que se dedicaba a bucear mientras vivía encima de un titán y ya está, ¿sabes? O sea, no mucho más. Y de repente se convierte en el piloto de la égida. No es como el caso de Amalthus. Amalthus es un pavo que conoce un montón de cosas y no sé qué, y ha vivido no sé cuántos cientos de años y bla, bla, bla. No. Rex es un chiquillo. Y por eso todo el mundo también se queda como... ¿Esto? ¿Este chiquillo es el piloto de la égida? Entonces, aquí sobre todo se puede notar eso. ¿Qué pasa el momento? O sea, ¿qué pasa psicológicamente cuando la persona se da cuenta de que verdaderamente no es Dios y no puede serlo? ¿Vale? ¿Qué pasa cuando esa persona va a darse cuenta de que de verdad es una persona y no está a la altura? ¿Vale? Eso es lo que pasa. Sin embargo, otra cosa que me gusta muchísimo, muchísimo de esta conversación, sobre todo más o menos desde la parte final de Nia hasta la parte final de Brigid, ¿vale? O sea, desde la parte final de Nia, es decir, los últimos 2-3 diálogos que tiene, que es cuando le empuja, y toda la parte de Brigid. Lo que le están diciendo es, vas a darte por vencido por un problema. Y... esto obviamente puede entenderse como una cosa... Oh, me encanta que Cassandra se gire cuando suena la mascarita. Qué guay. Me gusta que se haga también de una forma como personal, ¿no? Que es lo que luego hace Poppy. Te vas a rendir una vez. Esto no es como lo sueles hacer tú. Tú sueles ser optimista, sueles intentar ir hacia adelante, sueles intentar hacer... ¿sabes? En este caso no es tan así, en este caso también se trata de otra manera y es la confianza que depositas en una relación. Rex tiene una relación con Pyra y Mithra y Rex está diciendo que se va a rendir al mínimo problema en el que sienta que no es lo suficientemente bueno para ella, va a dejarlo estar, va a decir ok, pues lo dejo porque no soy suficiente, ¿vale? Y lo que te está intentando tratar el videojuego, de lo que te está hablando, es de que en cualquier tipo de relación, si tú haces algo mal, si tú la cagas, si tú haces daño a alguien, Quedarte en ti mismo, lamentarte, pero no hacer nada por la otra persona no lleva a ningún sitio, sobre todo dentro del contexto de la relación. Así que a lo mejor estoy leyendo too much into this, no sé cómo se dice. A lo mejor le estoy dando muchas vueltas, ¿vale? Pero yo lo entiendo de esa manera, y más adelante creo que se mantiene un poquitito más todo esto que estoy diciendo. Pero Rex tiene eso. Tiene ese punto de decir, me voy, abandono, no puedo con esto, no soy suficiente para Pyra, barra Mithra. Y todo el mundo le dice, ¿tienes puta idea de lo que estás haciendo? ¿Estás haciendo cosas por ti? Y tú le haces daño, ok. Y en lugar de decir, bueno, pues, voy a intentar arreglar el daño que he hecho, no, te rindes. Ahí está el punto. No voy a seguir mucho más porque más adelante, como digo, creo que se presentan cosas que le dan más importancia y más relevancia a todo lo que estoy diciendo. Así que vamos a hablar con Eulogímenos, el rey. Ya veremos qué nos quiere decir. Y a partir de aquí, por cierto, es un punto bastante gracioso porque no tengo tercer blade atacante y no pienso... Oh, tengo a Sammy y a Rock, que supongo que cuando lleguen. Igualmente... Fuego, viento... Da bastante igual, ahora que lo estoy pensando. Vamos a aceptarlo del mermer, rápido. Mi novia ha pillado casi nada de la finigrama. Ya, 18.36. Vamos de nuevo a Tantal, sí. Salida de Tantal mismo. Hombre, ok. No, voy a poner todo esto y esto. Simplemente quiero que los blades más raros que tengo pillen confianza con Dante. Vaya. Cuando lleguen las patrullas ya veré qué me pongo. Viento me da más pereza. Creo que además Rock no es que sea extremadamente bueno. A Sammy tampoco. Que ese es el problema. Ah, con lo mucho que me gusta Sammy, tío. El rollo de Rock... bastante... meh, como Blade. No lo puedo ver mientras estoy en el mermel. Luego comprobamos y tal. En fin, cinemática. Creo, sí.
¿Estás bien para estar arriba y abajo? Sí. Estoy
todo curado.
Sinceras apologías. If I hadn't attempted to destroy the Aegis, they would never have...
If you'd done nothing, they'd have come for her anyway. You're not to blame, Your Majesty. It's... my fault.
500 years ago, this kingdom was rent in twain. Some followed Adam, who sought to live with Blades and Titans as equals. Others opposed him, preferring to consider humans as the masters and Titans as our tools. When Adam returned to the Aether, his rivals seized power, leveraging the power of the Omega Fetter. They declared themselves the Tantalese Royal Dynasty,
claiming they were the hero Adam's descendants.
Precisely. My ancestors merely used the name of the beloved Adam in order to win over the people.
Hmm.
Before long, we resolved to protect ourselves from meddlesome foreigners by descending deep into the Cloud Sea, taking the dirty secret of our family's lineage with us. The Praetorium, for their part, did not protest. Can you guess why?
No.
They offered to stay silent in exchange for a certain resource. An annual tribute comprising a fixed quantity of core chips. I have something I wish to show you.
What is it? What is this?
This is Gembo's Aether Flow. The Titan draws in the fabric of the Cloud Sea, and uses it as a source of energy. This energy flows throughout the Titan's body in the form of ether. Refining and crystallizing this ether creates core chips. This process is what you see before you.
So, in other words, you're siphoning away a portion of the Titan's energy.
Our cold climate and poor harvests, they are the unfortunate side effects of this process.
I think I'm beginning to understand.
Core chips are vital to every nation's military and energy policies. The Praetorium desired this power.
How come?
All rest at the time was in crisis. But for the Praetorium, it was a precious chance to expand their sphere of influence.
So they missiled it.
As a result, Tantal fell into a chronic energy shortage. Then, well, you saw for yourselves. Near frozen earth, failing crops, the Tantalese people are forced to live in abject poverty.
So why not just leave the Cloud Sea? Genbu can move, right? Just go somewhere warmer.
They fear contact with other nations. Too afraid it might expose the truth behind the legends they spun about Adam.
That would explain their isolationism.
Indeed. That was 5 centuries ago. Now the Aegis has awakened. The Praetorium is demanding we hand over the Omega Fetter. They are threatening to reveal our secret if we do not acquiesce.
Indala? Threatening you?
I get it now. That's what was in that letter.
Enough was enough. I couldn't stand by and let the Tantalese people suffer any longer. Therefore, I made a decision.
And that's why you...
Yes. I knew there was a chance that the Praetorium would use the Aegis against us. But if I could neutralize her power, perhaps we would stand a chance of opposing them. And perhaps by saving my people from poverty, I could absolve the sins of my forefathers.
You didn't think about using the Aegis's power yourself?
Wielding such power is beyond my means. I am under no illusions. However, does the same apply to you? I felt something. When I looked in your eyes, I knew. Perhaps you are the one to whom we can entrust the Aegis's power.
Father.
In the end, it seems I only managed to make things worse. I can blame nothing but my own judgment. This tome records the deeds of the hero Adam. According to this, he saved the world from destruction using a white sword, and then disappeared, along with a red sword.
White and red? It must mean Mithra and Pyrrha's swords.
Whoever wrote this must have had a personal connection to Adam. And, most curiously, after Adam disappeared, the author of this book went looking for something.
Something?
The third Aegis sword.
There's a third?
Apparently, this sword was as transparent as diamond and gave off a clear, brilliant light. But Adam went his whole life without using the sword. In fact, he could not use it.
What do you mean, couldn't?
The sword was simply too powerful. Even he, the legendary hero, could not contain the power it commanded. And thus, fearing its power, he sealed it away somewhere. The author therefore surmised that this sword alone was the one true sword of the Aegis. Now, Rex, you were defeated by Jin. Doubtless that man is a powerful warrior. But even so, can this be right? Can the Aegis herself truly be outmatched by a single opposing blade? Would it not make more sense to presume that you lost because you have yet to unlock the true power of the Aegis?
You mean I'm the one who's been holding them back?
Your Majesty, where is that sword? We have to find it somehow. We have to find that sword and rescue Pyro and Mithra.
Regrettably, the book does not specify the sword's location.
But there must be.
However, reading between the lines, it seems the author suspected that the sword lies somewhere in Lefthiria. It's not much, but that's where I would begin the search.
In Lefthiria.
Are you ready?
Huh?
Are you ready to do what it takes to be their true driver?
Gramps?
Well, are you, Rex?
Yes! Of course! I'm going to be the driver that Pyra and Mithra deserve. And then, I'm going to take them to Elysium.
Then come with me. I'll show you the way.
My son.
Yeah?
I have a favor to ask of you as your king.
Well, that's a first. Are you feeling okay, old man? Maybe you're coming down with something.
The Aegis needs... No, rather the boy needs protection.
You mean Rex?
Yes. I saw something in that boy's eyes. A light that must never go out.
Steady on, old man. People get the wrong idea. Fine. Leave it to me.
Thank you.
Nah, it's not like I wasn't gonna go with him anyway.
You really can't judge a book by its cover. Who'd have thought that sweet-looking girl would threaten to destroy herself? Didn't she realize taking her own life would mean the boy died too?
Oh, she knew exactly what she was doing.
The whole thing was a bluff then?
No, not at all. The reason she gave her core crystal to the boy was to replace his heart after Jin put paid to it. An Aegis core encodes the blueprints for all life. She took advantage of that.
Incredible. I had no idea such a thing was possible. Aegises truly are a breed apart.
Cores are constantly accumulating data about the outside world. The fact that their injuries are mirrored is a result of their twin cores exchanging information. If you wanted to be poetic about it, you could say that their very lives are intertwined. But there's nothing to stop her from severing that link.
What do you mean?
Before issuing the kill order to the artifice, she would have transferred the remainder of her core to the boy. Letting him live on, heart complete. An Aegis can survive for a short time without a core crystal. Don't ask me why. It's just how we were made.
So that's the reason Jin agreed to her terms.
He couldn't care less about the boy. But he wasn't about to lose this one. Simple as that.
Bueno, cinemática, ok. Madre mía, media hora de cinemáticas. Es lo típico, ¿eh? Cuando empezamos un nuevo capítulo, generalmente hay 20, 30 minutos de cinemática. Además, me he pasado un rato explicando la otra cinemática. Y al respecto de esto tengo más bien poco que decir igualmente. Lo único es, de nuevo, el tema de Tantal. Ahora se descubre toda la trama de Tantal y me gusta porque, de nuevo, simplemente te han ido dando pistas en el guión, pero te han ido dando pistas mediante conversaciones que tienen sentido en el momento. Así que es una cosa que me gusta mucho. Fuera de eso, no hay mucho más que decir. El dueño del libro, se entiende que es Minoth / Cole. Y fuera del resto, Eulogímenos, bla bla bla, explica todo lo de Tantal, lo de Lefthiria. No hay mucho más. Rex de repente vuelve a ser sí mismo. Y la parte de los Core Crystals y tal, simplemente explicaciones, no tengo mucho que aportar aquí. Vamos a continuar.